there's nothing that's against the rules. If I feel that I want to write in first person and completely make it up, then I'm going to do it. And I realize that it's a powerful, you know, the I in songwriting is powerful because people tap into the celebrity of it, really. They go, oh, that guy. And I don't mean that I'm a celebrity, but I mean as they're interested in the personality behind it. The guy that's singing that actually did that. And so I think that can be a good thing. In the case of Brick, it's a very true, naked, completely literal song about what happened to my girlfriend in high school. You know, 16 years old and didn't know any better, and she got pregnant, and there you go. And it was a really, really tough year. I mean, it went a lot tougher than the song is ever going to say. But what I wanted to do after that, from that point on, I always wanted to write a song, and I tried lots of different ways of capturing the feeling of being a teenager and having to grow up in 2 seconds. And as you grow up, something dies at the same time. That's how I feel like I did it. I mean, I've said before, that I didn't want it to be a political statement, and I didn't want it to be, sensationalized. So when the song was out, I never talked about it. I never answered a single question about the song. I just wanted to. I figured if someone's gone through the experience, they'll know it when they hear the song. They'll know what that is. And I mean, Jesus, I remember having to sell stuff. That's one of the lines in the thing. It was around Christmas, and I'd gotten gifts for Christmas, and we couldn't afford this, you know. So I was out at pawn shops, nasty parts of town, all over the place, trying to sell the stuff that I'd gotten for Christmas. And my parents dropped by a stereo store and caught me selling my tape deck. The whole family had chipped in and bought this tape deck that I'd always wanted, a JVC tape deck. And I'd gotten it early. I knew what I'd gotten. I talked to them to give me early. And then I go to the stereo shop. Maybe the stereo guy called my parents, but they both came in the store, and I'm standing there with the stereo salesman getting the money for it. They didn't know. They knew something was going on in my life, but they didn't know what it was. And my girlfriend was suicidal, and it was a bad year. Yeah. When you have a hit song, much of your fan base and people who listen to your music, their opinion is going to be loud and clear that they feel that you've abandoned the fan base. You've written something that's not for them. It's for everybody else. You've sold out, all kinds of things like that. And that's like when we wrote and recorded the song and it came out, that was the overwhelming vibe. That was my neighbors were listening, because we recorded our house, were listening up against the house, and didn't try to hide their opinion when we walked out, and they'd heard it like, what is that crap? Because we've been playing silly up-tempo. We were the piano band that rocks. That was my first brush with that, and it stayed that way. And we couldn't even fit the song into a show. But when I look back on it, I think that the fact that that song was a hit, it gives me some confidence in pop music, because the song is completely honest what it is. It's crafted well. It's relaxed. It's recorded in a way that we'd never recorded a song before, which is absolutely live, 3 or 4 microphones in a bedroom. The song could not have more integrity than it had. It was also probably the first notable collaboration, too, because Darren had that chorus, "She's a Brick and I'm Drowning Slowly." That was his contribution. And though that's a small contribution to the song, that happens to be probably the bar of music that most people remember out of everything that we did and I've done. That's it, and that was his contribution, and it's not bad. It's a cool little – it's like a home run. He writes – hit choruses, and I really don't. I've never understood a hit chorus. I wish I did, because I'd, you know, be much better off if I did, but I don't get them. But I knew that that was something, and when he showed that to me a couple years before we actually did the song, he goes, "I've been sitting around with this song. My friends think it sucks. What do you think?" And of course they think it sucks. Everyone's trying to be too damn cool all the time. And it's like, "He's a brick and I'm drowning." And I just thought, this is something, but I don't know what it is. And I've been trying to express this whole thing of the high school abortion, and I'd been trying to do it too literally, and I tried several versions of songs, and when he did that, I was like, wow, that's just like abstract enough. If you paste it on, suddenly there's something there. And the other element of the song is we were opening up for Neil Young at the time that I wrote the song, and I was inspired by his ability to make a stadium feel like a living room. And we were making living rooms feel like stadiums. I felt this is backwards. Like we go on little punk rock clubs and we try to make it into this big hairy deal. And there's Neil sitting there like no one's there except for two people in his living room, captivating a whole audience. And that inspired me to write that song too, just to write something that wasn't trying so hard to rope everybody in. And look what happened. It roped everybody in.